Hello, welcome to the video lecture series on digital image processing. Till the last class, we have talked about the image digitization process and we have seen that there are two steps involved for digitization of an image. The first step is image sampling, in which case instead of taking the possible intensity values at every possible location in the image, we take the pixel values or intensity values at some discrete locations in the two-dimensional space, and this is the process that we call as image sampling. After sampling, what we get is some discrete set of points, and at those discrete set of points, we get the sample values. And the sample values or the intensity values at those discrete set of points are analog in nature. So, the final step of digitization of an image is the quantization, in which case those analog sample values are quantized to one of the discrete levels. And depending upon the number of levels that we choose, the number of bits needed to represent each and every sample value is different. So, in general, what is used is 8 bits for digitization or quantization of every sample value. So, if it is a black and white image or a simple gray label image, then per point or per pixel we have 8 bits, whereas if it is a color image, and we know that in case of color image there are 3 different planes, the red plane, green plane and blue plane. For each of these different planes, every point is represented by 8 bits. So, for a color image, normally we have 24 bits for every pixel, whereas for a gray level image or black and white image, we have 8 bits per pixel. So, after digitization, what we have found is that an image is represented in the form of a matrix or a two-dimensional matrix, which we call a digital image, and each of the matrix elements is now called a pixel. Now, when we represent the image by a matrix and the different points are called pixels, then it is found that some important relationships exist among those pixels. And in today's lecture, we will try to find out what are the different important relationships that exist among different pixels of an image. So, in today's lecture, we will try to see that what are the relationships that exist among the pixels of an image. And among these relationships, the first relationship that we will talk about is the neighborhood, and we will also see that what are different types of neighborhood of a pixel in an image. Then we will also try to explain that what is meant by connectivity in an image. We will also learn the connected component leveling algorithm, the importance of this connected component leveling algorithm and the properties that is connectivity we will discuss about later. We will also explain what is adjacency, and we will see what are the different types of adjacency relationships. Then we will also learn different distance measures, and towards the end of today's lecture, we will try to find out what are the different image operations. We will try to see that what are pixel by pixel operations and what are the neighborhood operations in an image. So, as we say that the first relationship is the pixel relationship or the neighborhood relationship. Now, let us first try to understand that what is meant by neighborhood. We say that the people around us are our neighbors, or we say that a person who is living in the house next to mine is my neighbor. So, it is the closeness of the different persons which forms the neighborhood of the persons. So, it is the persons who are very close to me, they are my neighbors. Similarly, in case of an image also, we say that the pixels are neighbor if the pixels are very close to each other. So, let us try to see formally what is meant by neighborhood in case of an image pixel. Here, let us consider a pixel at location, a pixel P at location xy, as shown is this middle pixel. Now, find that because the image in our case is represented by a two-dimensional matrix, so the matrix will have a number of rows and a number of columns. So, when I consider this pixel P whose location is xy, that means the location of the pixel in the matrix is in row number x, in row x and in column y. Obviously, there will be a row which is just before x, that is row x minus 1. There will be a row just after the row x, which is row x plus 1. Similarly, there will be a column just before the column y, that is column y minus 1, and there will be a column just after column y, which is column y plus 1. So, come back to this figure. Coming to this particular pixel P, which is at location x, y, I can have two different pixels. One is in the row just above row x, other one is in the row just below row x, but in the same column location y. So, I will have two different pixels. One is in the vertically upward direction, the other one is in the vertically downward direction. So, these are the two pixels which are called the vertical neighbors of point P. Similarly, if I consider the columns, there will be a column pixel at location x I minus y minus 1, that is in row number x, column number y minus 1. There is a pixel x and y plus 1, that is row number x and column number y plus 1. So, in this case, these are the two pixels which are the horizontal neighbors of the point P. So, in this case, these are not 4, rather this should be 2, here this will also be 2. So, this pixel P has two neighbors in the horizontal direction and two neighbors in the vertical direction. So, these total 4 pixels are called 4 neighbors of the point P and is represented by P equal to and is represented by N4P. That is, these pixels are 4 neighbors of the pixel P or point P. Each of these neighbors, if you find out the distance between these neighboring pixels, you find that each of these neighbors is at a unit distance from point P. Obviously, if P is a boundary pixel, then it will have less number of neighbors. Let us see why. So, I have a two-dimensional image, where this image is represented in the form of a matrix. So, I have pixels in different rows and pixels in different columns. Now, if this pixel P, the point P, is one of the boundary pixels, say I take this corner pixel, then as we said that for a pixel P, usually there are 4 different pixels taken from a row above it, a row below it, the column before it and the column after it. But when I consider this particular pixel P, this pixel P does not have any pixel in the row above this pixel, it does not have any pixel in the column before this particular column. So, for this particular pixel P, I will have only 2 neighboring pixels, one is in this location, the other one is in this location, which are part of 4 neighbor or N4P. So, find that for all the pixels which belong to the boundary of an image, the number of neighboring pixels is less than 4, whereas for all the pixels which belong to which is inside an image, the number of neighborhood pixels is equal to 4. So, this is what is the 4 neighborhood of a particular pixel. Now, as we have done, as we have taken the points from vertically upward direction and vertically downward direction, or horizontally from the left as well as from right. Similarly, we can find that there are 4 other points which are in the diagonal direction. So, those points are here. Again, I consider this point P at location x, y, but now if I consider the diagonal points, you find that there are 4 diagonal images, there are 4 diagonal points, one at location x minus 1, y minus 1, the other one at location x plus 1, y plus 1, one at location x minus 1, y plus 1, and the other one is at location x plus 1 and y minus 1. Now, we say that these 4 pixels, because they are in the diagonal direction, these 4 pixels are known as the diagonal neighbors of point P, and it is represented by NDP. So, I have got 4 pixels which belong to N4P, that is, those are the 4 neighbors of point P, and I have got 4 more points which are the diagonal neighbors or represented by NDP. Now, I can combine these 2 neighborhoods and I can say an 8 neighborhood. So, again coming back to this, if I take the points both from N4P and NDP, they together are called 8 neighbors of point P and represented by N8P. So, obviously, this N8P is the union of N4P and NDP. And naturally, as we have seen in the previous case, that if the point P belongs to the boundary of the image, then NDP, the number of diagonal neighbors of the point P will be less than 4. Similarly, the points belonging to N8P or the number of 8 neighbors of the point P will be less than 8. Whereas, if P is inside an image, it is not a boundary point. In that case, there will be 8 neighbors, 4 in the horizontal and vertical directions and 4 in the diagonal directions. So, there will be 8 neighbors of point P if point P is inside an image. So, these are the different neighborhoods of the point P. Now, after this, we have another property which is called as connectivity. Now, the connectivity of the points in an image is a very, very important concept which is used to find out the region property of an image or the property of a particular region within the image. You recollect that in our introductory lectures, we have given an example of segmentation. That is, we had an image of certain object and we wanted to find out the points which belong to the object and the points which belong to the background. And for doing that, we had used a very, very primitive operation called the thresholding operation. So, here in this particular case, we have shown that if the intensity value or if x y at a particular point x y is greater than certain threshold set T h, in that case, we decided that the point x y belongs to the object. Whereas, if the point or the intensity level at the point x y is less than the threshold, then we have said, we had decided that the point x y belongs to the background. So, by performing this operation, and if you represent every object point as a white pixel or assign a value 1 to it, and every background pixel as a black pixel or assign a value 0 to it, in that case, the type of image that we will get after the thresholding operation is like this. So, here this is the original image And you find that for all the points which belong to the object, the intensity value is greater than the threshold. So, the decision that we have taken is these points belong to the object. So, in case of segmented image or the thresholded image, we have assigned a value 1 to each of those image points. Whereas, in other regions, a region like this, we decided that these points belong to the background. So, we have assigned a value 0 to these particular points. Now, just by performing this operation, what we have done is we have identified certain number of pixels, the pixels which belong to background and the pixels which belong to the object. But just by identification of the pixels belonging to the background, I cannot, or the pixels belonging to the object, I cannot find out what is the property of the object until and unless I do some more processing to say that those pixels belong to the same object. That means, I have to do some sort of grouping operation. Not only this, I can have a situation like this. Say for example, I have in this entire image two different objects. One object may be in this location and another object may be say somewhere here. So, just by using this thresholding operation, what I have done is I have decided that all the pixels in this region will get a value 1, all the pixels in this region will also get a value 1. So, both these two sets of pixels, they belong to the object. But here our solution does not end there. We have to identify that a set of pixels or this particular set of pixels belong to one object, this particular set of pixels belong to another object. They do not belong to the same object. So, for this, what is needed is I have to identify that which pixels are connected, and I also have to identify which pixels are not connected. So, I will say that the pixels having value equal to 1 which are connected, they belong to one region, and the another set of pixels or points having value equal to 1 but not connected to the other set, they belong to some other object. So, this connectivity property between the pixels is a very, very important property, and using this connectivity property, we can establish the object boundaries. We can find out what is the area of the object, and likewise we can find out many other properties of the object or the descriptors of the object which will be useful for further high level processing techniques where we will try to recognize or identify a particular object. So, now let us try to see that what is this connectivity property, what do we mean by connectivity. We say that two pixels are connected if they are adjacent in some sense. So, this term some sense is very, very important. So, this adjacent means that they have to be neighbors. That means, one pixel, if I say that two pixels, two points P and Q are connected, then by adjacency we mean that P must be a neighbor of Q or Q must be a neighbor of P. That means, Q has to belong to N4P or NDP or N8P. And in addition to this neighborhood, one more constant that has to be put is that the intensity values or the gray levels of the two points P and Q must be similar. So, let us take this example. Here we have shown two three different situations where we have taken points P and Q. So, here you find that point Q, it belongs to the four neighborhood of point P. Here point Q belongs to the diagonal neighborhood of point P. Here again point Q belongs to the 4 neighborhood of point P. And in this case, we will say that point P and Q are connected. Obviously, the neighborhood restriction holds true because Q and P, they are neighbors. And along with this, we have said that another restriction or another constraint must be satisfied, that their intensity values must be similar. So, in this particular case, because we are considering a binary image, so we will say that if Q belongs to the neighborhood of P or P belongs to the neighborhood of Q, and the intensity value at point P is same as the intensity value at point Q. So, because it is binary image, this value will be either 0 or 1. So, in this case, if I assume that if the pixels have value equal to 1, then we will assume that those two pixels to be connected. So, in this case, if for both P and Q, the intensity value is equal to 1, and since they are the neighbors, so we will say that points P and Q are connected. Now, from this connectivity, can be defined in a more general way. So, the earlier example that we have taken is the connectivity of, in case of a binary image, where the intensity values are either 0 or 1. This connectivity property can also be defined in case of gray level image. So, how do we define connectivity in case of a gray level image? In case of a gray level image, we define a set of gray levels. Say, for example, in this case, we have defined V to be a set of gray levels, which is used to define the connectivity of two points P and Q. So, the if intensity values at points P and Q belongs to the set V, so this is not point P by P and Q, but the intensity values are F P and F Q. So, the if the intensity values at the points P and Q belong to set V and points P and Q are neighbors, then we say that points P and Q are connected. And here again, we can define three different types of connectivity. One is 4 connectivity, that is, in this case, the intensity values at P and Q must be from the set V, and P must be a 4 neighbor of Q, or Q must be a 4 neighbor of P. In that case, we define 4 connectivity. Similarly, we define 8 connectivity if the intensity values at point P and Q belong to the set V, and P is an 8 neighbor of Q, or Q is an 8 neighbor of P. There is another type of connectivity which is defined, which is called M connectivity or mixed connectivity. So, in case of M connectivity, it is defined like this, that P and Q, the intensity values at points P and Q, obviously, they have to be from the same set V, and if Q belongs to neighborhood of P or Q belongs to NDP, that is diagonal neighborhood of P, and N4P intersection with N4Q is equal to phi. So, this concept extends or puts some restriction on the 8 connectivity, in the sense that here we say that either Q has to be a 4 neighbor of P, or P has to be a 4 neighbor of Q, or Q has to be a diagonal neighbor of P, but at the same time N4P intersection with N4Q must be equal to phi. And you find that this N4P intersection with N4Q, this indicates the set of points which are 4 neighbors of both the points P and Q. So, this says that if the point Q belongs to the diagonal neighbor of P, and there is a common set of points which have 4 neighbors to both the points P and Q, then M connectivity is not valid. So, the reason why this M connectivity is introduced is to avoid some problems that may arise with simple 8 connectivity concept. Let us see what are these problems. So, the problem is like this. Here again we have taken the example from a binary image, and in case of a binary image we say that two points may be connected if the values of both the points equal to 1. So, set V contains a single intensity value which is equal to 1. Now, here we have depicted one particular situation where we have shown the different pixels in a binary image. So, we find that if I consider this point at the middle of this image which is having a value 1, there is one more pixel on the row above this which is also having a value 1, and a diagonal pixel which is having a value 1, and a diagonally downward pixel which is also having a value equal to 1. Now, if I define 4 connectivity, then you find that this point is 4 connected to this point, this point is 4 connected to this point, because this particular point is member of the 4 neighbor of this particular point, this point is member of 4 neighbor of this point. But by 4 connectedness, this point is not connected because this is not a 4 neighbor of any of these points. Now, from 4 connectivity, if I move to 8 connectivity, then what I get? Again, I have the same set of points. Now, you find that we have defined 8 connectivity to be an union of, or 8 neighborhood to be an union of 4 neighborhood and diagonal neighborhood. So, because this is union of 4 neighborhood and diagonal neighborhood, so I will have set of points which are connected through 4 neighbors. I will also have set of connections or set of points which are connected through diagonal neighbors. So, as shown in the second figure, here you find that when I consider this central pixel, again these two connectivities which are 4 connectivity, they exist. In addition to this, this point which was not connected considering the 4 neighborhood now gets connected because this belongs to the diagonal neighborhood of this central point. So, these two points are also connected. Now, the problem arises here. This point was connected through 4 neighborhood, and at the same time this point, because this is a diagonal neighbor of the central point, so this point is also connected through this diagonal neighborhood. So, if I consider this situation and I simply have 8 connectivity, I consider 8 connectivity, then you find that multiple number of paths for connection exist in this particular case. So, the M connectivity or mixed connectivity has been introduced to avoid this multiple connection path. So, you just recollect the restriction that we have put in case of mixed connectivity. In case of mixed connectivity, we have said that two points are M connected if one is the 4 neighbor of other, or one is 4 neighbor of other and at the same time they do not have any common 4 neighbor. So, just by extending this concept in this case, you find that for M connectivity, these are diagonal neighbors, so this they are connected, but these two points, though they are diagonal neighbors, but they are not M connected because these two points have a point here, this point is a 4 neighbor of this, at the same time this point is 4 neighbor of this. So, when I introduce this 4 connectivity concept, you find that the problem that arises, that is the multipath connection which have come in case of 8 connectivity, no more exists in case of M connectivity. So, in case of M connectivity, even if we consider the diagonal neighbors, but the problem of multiple path does not arise. So, this is the advantage that you get in case of M connectivity. Now, from the connectivity, we come to the relationship of adjacency. So, we say that two pixels P and Q are adjacent if they are connected. So, since for connectivity, we have introduced three different types of connectivity, that is 4 connectivity, 8 connectivity and M connectivity. So, for all these three different types of connectivity, we will have three different types of adjacency, because our adjacency definition is two points are adjacent if they are connected. So, just by extension of this definition, you find that we have got three different types of adjacency. The first one is 4 adjacency, the second one is 8 adjacency and the third one is M adjacency. And you define this type of adjacency depending upon the type of connectivity that is used. Now, this is about the adjacency of two different points or two or more different points. We can extend this concept of adjacency to image regions. That is, we can also say that two image regions may be adjacent or they may not be adjacent. So, what is the condition for adjacency of two image regions? So, in this case, you find that we define the adjacency for two image regions like this, that if there are two image subsets S I and S j, we say that S I and S j will be adjacent if there exists a point P in image region S I and a point Q in image region S j such that P and Q are adjacent. Okay. So, just let us try to elaborate this. So, I have this overall image region, this is the whole image, and within this image I have two image regions, one is here, the other one is here. So, the adjacency relation between two image regions is defined like this, that I have to have some point in one region which is adjacent to a point in the other region. So, if I call, say this is image region S I and this is image region S j, then I must have some point P in image S I and some other point Q in image S j, so that this P and Q, they are adjacent. So, if P and Q are adjacent, then I say that this image region S I is adjacent to image region S j. That means, S I and S j, they must appear one after the other, one adjacent to the other. So, this is the adjacency relation. After the adjacency relation, we can also define a path between two points P and Q. So, the definition of a path is like this, that we say that a path exists from a point P having a coordinate x y to a point Q having coordinate s t, if there exists a sequence of distinct pixels, say x 0 y 0, x 1 y 1, x 2 y 2 and so on up to x n y n, where x 0 y 0 is equal to x y, that is the same as point P, and x n y n is equal to s t, which is the same as point Q. And all the other intermediate points like x 1, y 1, x 2 and y 2, they must be adjacent, the subsequent points must be adjacent, in the sense that x I y y y I has to be adjacent to x minus 1 y minus 1 for all values of I lying between 1 and n. So, if I have such a sequence of points between P and Q, such that all the points which are traversed in between P and Q, all those subsequent points they are adjacent, then we say that a path exists between from point P to point Q. And we also define the length of the path to be the n. That is, considering both point P and Q, if I have n plus 1 number of points including the end points P and Q and all the points in between, then the length of the path is said to be n. So, this is what we define as path. Now, a very important concept that can arise from here, that is how to define a connected region. We have said that two pixels are connected. We say two pixels are connected if they are adjacent in some sense, that is they are neighbors, and their intensity values are also similar. We have also defined two regions to be adjacent if there is a point in one region which is adjacent to some other point in another region. And we have also defined a path between a point P and Q if there are a set of points in between which are adjacent to each other. Now, this concept can be extended to define what is called a connected component. So, let us see what is a connected component. We take a subset S of an image I and we take two points P and Q which belong to this subset S of image I. Then we say that P is connected to Q in S. So, you just mind this term, that P is connected to Q in the subset S if there exists a path from P to Q consisting entirely of pixels in S. For any such P belonging to S, the set of pixels in S that are connected to P is called a connected component of S. So, the concept is like this. Say, this is my entire image I, and within this image, I take a sub image, say S. Okay. And here, say we have a point P. And we say that take any other point Q, if there exists a path from P to Q consisting of all other intermediate points, these intermediate points must also belong to the same subset S. So, there exists a path between P and Q consisting of intermediate points belonging to the same subset S, then we say that the point P and Q, they are connected. And if there are a number of such points to which a path exists from P, then set of all these points are said to be connected to P and they form a connected component of S. So, find that just by using this concept of connected component, I can identify a region in an image. So, going back to our earlier example, where we have said that simply by identifying that a pixel belongs to an object does not give me the entire solution, because I have to group the pixels which belong to the same object and give them some identification that these are the group of pixels which belong to the same object, and then I can go for extracting the region property which will tell me what is the property of that particular object. And now that belongingness to a particular object can be found out by using this concept of connected component. So, any two pixels of a connected component, we say they are connected to each other, and distinct connected components are disjoint. Obviously, the points belonging to one particular region and points belonging to another particular region, they are not connected, but the points belonging to a particular region, they are connected with each other. So, for this identification or group identification, what we have to do is, when we identify a set of pixels which are connected, then for all those points belonging to a particular group, we have to assign a particular identification number. So, for example, in this particular figure, you find that there are two groups of pixels. So, in the first figure, we have a set of pixels. Here, we have another set of pixels here. So, find that these set of pixels are connected, these set of pixels, they are also connected. So, this forms one connected component, this set of pixels form another connected component. So, this connected component labeling problem is that I have to assign a group identification number to each of these pixels. That means, the first set of pixels which are connected to each other, I have to give them one group identification number. In this particular case, all these pixels are identified to be yellow, and I have to give another group identification to this second set of pixels. So, in this particular case, all these pixels are given the color red. Now, once we identify this group of pixels to belong to a particular region, then we can go for finding out some region properties, and those region properties may be shape of that particular region, it may be area of that particular region, it may be the boundary, the length of the boundary of this particular region, and many other shape, area or boundary based features can be extracted once we identify these different region properties. So, now let us see that what will be the algorithm that has to be followed for to find out what is the group identification for a particular region or the pixels belonging to a particular region. So, the idea will be, the algorithm will be like this, that you scan the image from left to right and from top to bottom. So, as shown in this particular figure, if I scan the image like this from left to right and from top to bottom. So, this will be our scanning order. And for the time being, let us assume that we are using 4 connectivity. So, by using this 4 connectivity, whenever we reach a particular point, say P, you find that before reaching this particular point P and following this order of scanning, the other 4 neighbors of point P which will be scanned is the point which is above this, that is point R in this particular figure, and the point which is just left to P, that is point T before this figure. So, before this particular point P is scanned, the point the belonging to 4 neighbors of P which will be scanned are points R and point T. So, by using this particular fact that which are the points which will be scanned before you scan point P, we can develop a component labeling algorithm. The purpose of the component labeling algorithm is to assign an identification number to each of the pixels, connected pixels, which will identify it to belong to a particular region. So, the steps involved will be like this. So, when I consider a point P, I assume that IP is the pixel value at that particular location. And I also say that LP will be the level assigned to the pixel at location P. Then the algorithm steps will be like this, that if IP equal to 0, because as we have seen in the previous case, that after segmentation, we say that whenever the intensity value at a particular location is above certain threshold, we assign a value 1 to that particular location. Whereas, if the intensity value is less than the threshold, we assign a value 0 to that particular location. So, by using this convention, when I want to find out the region property based on the shape, the pixels which are of importance, or the points which are of importance, are the points having a value equal to 1, and we assume the points having a value equal to 0, they belong to the background, so they are not of importance. So, just by this, if a point has a value equal to 0, that is IP equal to 0, we do not assign any level to this. So, we just move to the next scanning position, either to the left, either to the right or to bottom. But if IP equal to 1, that is the value at a particular point equal to 1, and we find while scanning this, we have come across two points R and T. So, when I find a point P for which value equal to 1 and the values at both the points R and T equal to 0, then we assign a new level to position P. If IP equal to 1 and only one of the two neighbors, that is R and T, is 1, and because R and T has already been scanned, so both R and T, if those values are equal to 1, should have got a particular level L. So, in this particular case, if IP equal to 1 and one of R and T is equal to 1, in that case, to P we assign the same level which was assigned to R or T, whichever was 1 before. Okay. So, if IP equal to 1 and only one of the two neighbor is 1, then assign the level of that neighbor to point P. But the problem comes if IP equal to 1 and both R and T are equal to 1. So, the problem becomes simpler, our assignment is simple. If the level which was assigned to T and the level which was assigned to R, that was same. So, if L R equal to L T, then you assign the same level to point P. So, you see in this particular case that if L R equal to L T, then L P gets L R, which is obviously same as L T. But the problem comes if the level assigned to R and the level assigned to T, they are not same. So, in this particular case, what we have to do is, we have to assign one of the two levels to point P, and we have to note that these two levels are equivalent, because P and T or P and R, they are adjacent, and for R and T, the levels are different. So, after doing this initial leveling, we have to do some post-processing, so that all these pixels P, R and T, they get the same level. So, here what you have to do is, we have to assign to point P one of the levels, the level of R or the level of T, and we have to keep a note that the level of the other pixel and the level of this, the level which is assigned to P, they are equivalent, so that in the post processing stage, this anomaly that has been generated, that can be avoided. So, at the end of the scan, all pixels with value 1 will have some level, and some of the levels will be equivalent. So, during post processing or the second pass, what we will do is, we will identify all the equivalent pairs to form an equivalent class, and we can assign a different level to each of these equivalent classes. And in the second pass, you go through the image once more, and for all the levels which belongs to a particular equivalence class, you replace its original level by the level that has been assigned to the equivalence class. So, these two passes gives, at the end of the second pass, you get a leveled image where you maintain, where you identify the region belongingness of a particular pixel by looking at what is the level assigned to that particular pixel. So, here let us come to see an example. So, in this particular example, you find that we have shown two different regions or two different connected regions of pixels having value equal to 1. So, here what we do is, during the initial pass, As we scan this image from left to right and from top to bottom, what we do is the first image that I get, I assign a level 1 to it. Then you continue your scanning. When you come to the second pixel, second white pixel, you find that by connectivity it belongs to the same region. But when I come to this particular pixel, if I go through the top pixel and the left pixel, I find that there is no other pixel which is having a value equal to 1. So, I have to assign a new value to this particular pixel, and this pixel gets a value equal to 2. Come to the next one, this pixel again gets a value equal to 1 because its top pixel equal to 1. Coming to the next one, this one gets a value equal to 2 because its top pixel has a value equal to 2. Come to the next one, this gets a value 3 because it has to be a new level, because neither its top neighbor nor the left neighbor has any other level. The next one again gets a value 3 because its left neighbor has the level 3. Again, this gets a value 1 because top neighbor is equal to 1. This gets a value 1 because the left neighbor is equal to 1. This gets a value 1. This gets a value 1. Now, you find that in this case, there is an anomaly, because for this pixel, the top pixel has level equal to 2 and the left pixel has value equal to 1. So, I have to assign one of these two levels to this particular pixel. So, here we have assigned level 1 to this pixel, and after this, what we have to do is, we have to declare that 2 and 1, they are equivalent. Then you continue your processing. Here again, I have to assign a new level because none of the top or the left pixel of this, neighbors of this, have got any level. So, it gets the level 4. Coming to the next one, here you find that its top one has got level 3 and left one has got level 4. So, I have to assign one of the levels, and in this case the level assigned is 4, but at the same time I have to keep a note that level 3 and level 4, they are equivalent. So, you mark 3 and 4 equivalent. So, if you continue like this, the next one is again 4, the next one again gets a 4, this one gets 1, this one again gets 1, this one gets 4, this one gets 4, this one gets a 5, that is a new level, because for this particular pixel, its top or left one does not have any level. Coming to the next one, it gets a level 1, because here the top pixel has already have a level 1. But at this particular point, we have to keep a note that 5 and 1 are equivalent. So, you note 5 and 1 to be equivalent. You continue like this, the other pixel gets the level 4, this pixel gets the level 4, this pixel gets the level 4, this pixel again gets the level 5 because its top pixel is already having a level equal to 5. So, at the end of this scanning, I get 3 equivalent pairs. One equivalent pair is 1, 2, the other equivalent pair is 3, 4, and the third equivalent is 1, 5. So, in the second pass, what I have to do is, I have to process these equivalent pairs to identify the equivalence classes. That means, the levels, all the levels which are equivalent. So, by processing this, you find that 1 and 2 and 1 and 5, they are equivalent. Okay? So, 1, 2 and 5, these two levels form a particular equivalence class. And similarly, 3 and 4, they are equivalent, forming an equivalence class. So, if I assign a level 1 to the equivalence class containing the levels 1, 2 and 5, and at the same time, I assign a level 3 to the equivalence class containing levels 3 and 4, then during the second pass, what I will do is, I will scan over this leveled image which is already leveled, and I will reassign the levels. So, wherever the level was equal to 1, I will maintain that equal to 1, and wherever I get a level which is 2 or 5, I will reassign that level to be equal to 1. So, in this particular case, if you remember, this pixel had got a level equal to 2. I reassign because 2 belongs to an equivalence class consisting of the levels 1, 2 and 5 to which we have assigned the level equal to 1. So, wherever I get level equal to 2, I reassign that level equal to 1. So, continue this way, this was already 1, this was 2 which has been reassigned to be 1, this was 3 which remains because 3 and 4 form equivalence class and the level assigned to this equivalence class is 3, this is also 3 that remains. This was 1 that remains, this was 1 that remains, this was 1 that remains, this was say possibly 2 or 1, so I make it equal to 1. This had got a level equal to 4, so that has been reassigned the level value equal to 3. So, you find that at the end of the second pass, I identify all the pixels belonging to a particular group to have a single level and similarly all the pixels belonging to this particular group to have another level. So, I will stop here today. I will continue with this lecture in the next class. Thank you.